So hello everyone, so we are going to study a very important today topic today, that is blood banking. And in blood banking we are going to first start with the very important topic of the blood banking. This is called as blood grouping. So blood grouping is a very important concept that should be clear in your mind, the concept should be crystal clear in your mind, because then only you'll be able to understand why do we do ABO typing in some blood components, why do we do RH typing in some components, in other components we do not know, we do not do it. So these concepts will be clear only when you understand the basics of it, okay? So let's understand the basics of the blood grouping first, okay? So to understand the basics of the blood grouping, first you should understand that we have lot of blood group systems in our body, okay? But predominantly, we are going to talk today about H and ABO. So you can just label, you can say this as ABO blood group system, but H is the precursor of it. So I've written it together so that you can remember. So this is ABO blood group systems. Second is your RH blood group systems. And third are some rare blood group systems which I'll be telling you, but they are very important for your clinical features. Some clinical features are very peculiar to some blood group systems which you should be knowing, okay? So we'll be focusing on this, and we will be focusing how do we test blood groups and what is the protocols that we follow in our blood banking, okay? With that overview, let's first start with the first blood group system, that is ABO blood group system, okay? Now, when I talk about ABO blood group system, the first thing that everybody should be clear is that ABO blood group system is not proteins. It is not protein at all. They are actually sugars. They are actually sugars, or can I say carbohydrate moieties. So they are basically carbohydrate moieties. They are not protein. Normally you've said that most of the antigens are actually proteins, but ABO blood group is a unique system because it is not protein, it is carbohydrate, they are sugars actually, okay? That's the first point you have to remember. So no, that is first. Number second point is that ABO blood group system, since it's sugar, it is present in lots and lots of organs of our body. So it can be either membrane bound, so either it can be present in the membranes of various cells, number one, either it can be present in the membranes of various cells. So which cells? So remember, all the cells of the hematopoietic system, okay, RBCs, WBCs, platelet, all have these ABO sugars. I'll just say them sugars so that you remember, sugars on their membranes. So all these cells have them. Second, they can be present in the secretions. They can be present in secretions. So all the secretions of the body have ABO system except CSF. All the secretions of the body have ABO blood group system except CSF. CSF doesn't have it, okay? So take any secretion, tears, saliva, breast milk, feces, urine, meconium, any secretion has ABO blood group system except CSF. So this is a very important point here. CSF does not have it. Third, other organs also, not only that, other organs also, like cervical epithelial cells, GI epithelial cells, these also have blood group systems. So not only they are present in the hemat, so what did you learn? Not only they are present in the hematopoietic cells, they are also present in secretion, and they can even be present in other cells like GI cells and cervical cells. So they are widespread, they are widespread, okay? So these sugars are widespread present in our body, okay? That's the second point we have to remember. Third point you should remember is that majority of the time, because these are the antigens which are normally present in our body, okay, they are present. So our body develops antibodies against them very early, okay, in the life. They're naturally present. So remember again, antibodies are always present against ABO blood group system, and they're naturally present antibody. What do you mean by that? Suppose if my blood group is A, in my blood, I will have naturally present anti-B antibodies, okay? So these are naturally present antibodies. So ABO blood groups are always, they always produce naturally, natural antibodies. And what is the nature of these antibodies? Remember, these antibodies are usually IgM in nature, but they can also be IgG, but predominantly they are IgM in nature. Okay, so these natural antibodies are usually IgM nature antibodies. Okay, so if anybody has a blood group A, his blood is going to have anti-B. And because this is an IgM antibody, they can fix complement very fast and they can damage. So that means if in an A blood group patient, you by chance transfuse B blood group, B blood, immediately his blood, so if I'm A blood group, my blood has anti-B antibody. If you give me B blood, okay, B will have antigen. My body already has natural IgM antibody. It will immediately lyse the cells, fix the complement. I will start presenting with intravascular hemolysis. Immediately hemoglobinuria will start. And this will be caused as hemolytic transfusion reaction, acute hemolytic transfusion reaction. It can be fatal. So these antibodies are very, very important antibodies because these are natural IgM antibodies. Okay, now because they are majority of the time IgM antibodies, therefore they usually do not cross placenta. Okay, and therefore hemolytic disease of newborn is not very common with ABO blood group system. But here I told you that they can, some of the subset can even be IgG. So small amount of IgG antibodies can also be present, and these are maximum in O blood group patient. Okay, so because O blood group, we'll see early after this, that O blood group does not have any antigen, so they have maximum amount of antibody. Okay, maximum amount of antibody. Okay, so if a mother is O blood group, she will have maximum titer of antibodies. So majority of these antibodies will be IgM, but she will also have some amount of IgG antibodies. So therefore these IgG antibodies from the mother, which can be anti-A or anti-B, suppose she has a fetus whose blood group is A, so these mothers will have some anti-A antibody which will be of IgG type, so they can cross the placenta and cause ABO, hemolytic disease of newborn. That is why. So point to remember here is that ABO hemolytic disease of the newborn is usually seen in O blood group mothers, especially when the child is either A blood group or B blood group, then mother we can have ABO hemolytic disease of newborn. Let me tell you a very interesting thing here. You know, I am A blood group and my mother is O blood group. Okay, and I was born with ABO hemolytic disease. Okay, so just a preview. So that's why, because my mother is O, so she will have high titers of anti-A, and I am A blood group, so the antibodies crossed and it caused ABO hemolytic disease. Okay, so remember that point always. Okay, so this is your natural IgM antibody. Anywhere else you have studied about natural IgM antibodies? Anywhere else do you think you have studied about it? Yes. Think. We have already talked about it. Hyperacute graft rejection. Okay, so hyperacute graft rejection. Whenever I'm talking about hyperacute graft rejections, now the recent update says that natural IgM antibody has a role in hyperacute graft rejections. So everybody should be very clear about this point. Okay, now that's about natural IgM antibodies. Now, once we are clear with this, now let's come to the structure. Okay, structure of the ABO blood group. So if I'm talking about the structure of ABO blood group, you should understand this. Okay, so I'm going to tell you this, how this happens. So of course, when we talk about the molecular genetics, we always go back to the DNA, isn't it? So in the DNA, there is a chromosome number 19. So we have a chromosome number 19. This chromosome number 19 codes for an enzyme which is called as fucosyl transferase. That's how it starts. Okay, so it codes for an enzyme called as fucosyl transferase. This fucosyl transferase adds fucose. Okay, so how does it adds fucose? Let's see. So you have seen that all the types of cells, many types of cells can have ABO blood group. So what happens is these cells usually have oligosaccharides attached to them. So majority of the cells like this. Okay, so I'm drawing the cells. These are the cells. Okay, so these cells have some oligosaccharides attached to them. So these are nothing but they are oligosaccharides. Okay, attached to that. So what happens is fucosyl transferase has given fucose. So this fucose comes and attaches here to these oligosaccharides. This fucose comes and attaches like this to the oligosaccharides, like this. Okay, so it attaches like this. So once this fucose attaches to the cells, okay, cells like this. This is what is called as H antigen. Now this becomes H antigen. So the first antigen to be formed in ABO blood group system is always H antigen. So from chromosome number 19, so which chromosome does H come from? Chromosome number 19. From the chromosome number 19, we get an enzyme which is called as fucosyl transferase. If you want to be more particular, it should be L-fucosyl transferase, remember? Fucosyl transferase. It codes for fucose, and this fucose goes and attaches to the cell, and this becomes H antigen. So everybody should be very clear about this, okay? So this is the first antigen to be formed. So this is the mother of the blood groups. This is the first antigens which are being formed, okay? So now, once we have got H antigen now let's see what happens. So this is the first antigen which is formed. Now, after this, there can be two pathways. After this, we can have two pathways now. So after this, we can have two pathways. So let us see, H antigen is formed. Now we have two pathways. Now, again, from a different chromosome, we are talking about from a different chromosome. So from chromosome number 9, so from different chromosome now, okay, so chromosome number 19 has done its work. So from chromosome number 9, two different enzymes can be formed, okay. So one enzyme is called as, let's see, one enzyme is called as, remember it as NAG, okay. This is N-acetylgalactosamine. What is this? N-acetylgalactosamine. Okay, galactosamine, or we can have galactose, and just I'm going to write transferase after that, okay, transferase after that, okay, transferase after that, okay. So from chromosome number 9, some people can form NAG transferase, some people can form galactose transferase, okay. So if it forms NAG transferase, so let's see, let's presume I'm going to draw NAG like this, okay, like a box like this. So this is NAG transferase, forms lots of NAG, that is N-acetylgalactosamines. They form lot of N-acetylgalactosamines. So can I say it NAG? So it forms lot of NAG. So once it forms NAG, now let's see what happens. Already you know, if I'm going to draw the structure of cell again, so this was the cell. It has lot of carbohydrate moieties, okay, so like this. Already we have studied that on these carbohydrate, what was attached? So I'll go back here. So what was attached here? This one, okay, so this is your diamond shaped, okay. So this is your fucose, okay. So let's say, I'm going to draw this for you here. So already, this diamond is there, isn't it? So that is, already fucose is there. Now, what is formed? NAG is formed. So now this NAG goes and attaches here. Okay, so this NAG goes and attaches here like this. So when this NAG attaches, so we have here fucose, we have here NAG. So when NAG attaches, this blood group is called A blood group. What is this blood group called? A blood group. This blood group is A blood group. Now let's go to the contrasting point here. So who was coming from the other side? Galactose transferase, okay, galactose transferase. So I'm going to make it in green now. So this is galactose transferase is coming, okay, so galactose transferase is coming. So let me draw the cell again. So this is a cell here. Already there was a carbohydrate moiety, already a diamond shape fucose was attached here, okay. Along with that, now this green color galactose is also attached, okay. So this galactose is also attached. So this is galactose, this is fucose. Now when galactose is attached, this forms B blood group. This forms B blood group. So can I say that what has occurred? So from chromosome number, look at this, from chromosome number 19, fucosyl transferase comes, which gives fucose to the red cells. So if this fucose attaches, and it forms the H antigen. Perfect. Now H antigen is formed. Once H antigen is formed, now H antigen is present on all the cells. Now from chromosome number 9, either NAG can form or galactose can form. So if NAG attaches, it becomes A blood group. or if galactose attaches, it becomes B blood group. So A is NOG, B is galactose. Okay, so remember, how do you remember it? So I'll just give you a small clue to remember it so that you remember it always. Okay, so remember this. Have you heard of Naga Babas? Okay, Naga Babas. If you go to Kumbh Mela, there'll be a lot of Naga Babas. Okay, so this is Naga Baba. Naga Baba, yeah, that means A blood group usually has Nag. A blood group usually has Nag. Okay, whereas when we talk about B, okay, B is a girl. B girl. Okay, girl. Girl means galactose. So B is a girl. So B girl. Okay, so clue to remember, B for boys. Boys love girls. Okay, usually. So B girls. So B is girls, galactose. Okay, so that's a clue to remember. So Naga Babas and B galactose. Okay, so that's your blood group, ABO blood group system, and the chromosome number you have started, that H is coming from 19 and B is coming from 9. Okay, so that's is your ABO blood group structure wise, which everybody has to be clear. Now remember, so I told you that if I am saying that I have A blood group in my body, A blood group in my body, okay, A blood group in the body, so can I say if I draw the structure of a person with O, let's say A blood group, he will have two antigens present. Okay, one is already there, H. Now remember, all the H is not converted into A. Okay, so there are fucosyl chains. Let me first explain it to you like this. So let's say this is an A blood group like this. So I told you majority of them have this diamonds, isn't it? So these diamonds were actually what? They were actually H substance. Okay, and then I told you that there was this, that is NOG. So this becomes A blood group. But remember, all the H antigens are not converted into A. Okay, few of them are left. Few of them are left. So any particular person who is A blood group will have two antigens present at any particular time. He will have H antigen and he will have A antigen. So that means if a person is A blood group, what are the two antigens which are present in him? H antigen is also present and A antigens are also present. So A blood group person has H and A on their red cells. So if the red cells have A and H, which antibody is present in their serum or plasma? So if you look at the plasma, okay, I'm going to write plasma, okay, because we are not testing it right now, so it doesn't matter I write serum or plasma, but I'm just writing. So this is cells which has A and H, so plasma will have anti-B antibody, anti-B antibody. So that's first. Now look at, I'm going to draw a B blood group person. So if it is a B blood group, can I say he will have two antigens, isn't it? He will have H and he will have B, because you now know that all the H is not converted into B. Some are still left. Okay, so which antibody will be present in the blood of the patient who is B blood group? He will have anti-A. Okay, what about this O blood group? O blood group means that what has happened? He has H. He already has H, but chromosome number 9 neither produces NOG, neither produces galactose transferase. So because neither NOG is produced, neither NOG transferase is produced, neither galactose transferase is produced. So nothing happens. Neither NOG attaches, neither galactose attaches. So it remains as H antigen only. So if I am talking about this, that is when there is no A antigen, there is no B antigen, but still which antigen is present? H antigen is still present, isn't it? So then this is what is called as, what is this blood group called as? O blood group. And O blood group will have anti-A and anti-B antibodies. Okay, so O blood group will have anti-A and anti-B antibodies. Are we clear about that? Okay, fine. So once we know that we have anti-A and anti-B antibodies which are present, now let us say we have, again, just a concept here. I hope everybody will be clear with the concept of alleles. I hope you understand the concept of alleles here. So whenever I am trying to understand the concept of allele, let me show you an example, okay? Allele means we get one copy of gene from our father, one copy of gene from our mother. Let's say father has a blonde color here, mother has a brown color here, okay? So definitely if I'm talking about the offspring, okay? So child will be having one allele from the father, which is blonde color here, one allele from the mother, that is brown color here, okay? So both the alleles together constitute genotype of the person. This is what is called genotype of the person, okay? So, but it does not define the phenotype. It will not be that, okay, child is born with a mixture of blonde and brown color hair. No. Child will be born with only one type of hair, depending upon who is dominant or depending upon which is not methylated, or many, many such mechanisms which we will be studying, which we will be studying in genetics, okay? For now, what you have to understand is that genotype means that both the alleles which are together present will constitute the genotype. Phenotype will be what is expressed. So let's say a child is born with blonde color hair. So what does that mean? That means the father's allele was probably dominant. Let's say one type probably dominant, so it expressed. You understand? So that's phenotype. So the child is born with blonde hairs, okay? But his genotype, genetically, he has both the alleles, one brown color and one blonde color, from both father and mother. Same way, when I'm talking about blood groups, so let's see this, okay? So when I'm talking about blood groups, okay? So same way, when I'm talking about blood groups, so let's say this is the father, okay? So father had A blood group. So both the alleles of the father were A, okay? Let's say mother. Okay, so I've drawn mother with the red color, father with the black color, okay? So father is black and mother is red, okay? So now, and let's say mother is B blood group. Now, when the child is born, he'll have one copy from the father and one copy from the mother, okay? So can I say which allele is coming from the father? Father has A. Which allele is coming from the mother? Mother has B. So now these are both A and B together, which is present in the child. So normally you heard that one should be expressing, isn't it? Which is what is dominant. They will express the phenotype. But here is the catch point. Remember, again, we'll be studying about this in detail in genetics. Remember, blood group follows codominance, okay? Okay, so blood banking follows the law of codominance. Blood banking follows the principle of codominance. Okay, that means both the alleles have the power to express together. So can I say this child, one allele, okay, so let's say A, one allele will be forming Naga. Okay, that is Nag transferase. The other allele will be forming galactose transferase. Okay, so one is forming galactose. So what will happen now? So if you look at the RBCs of this patient, this is the RBC, okay, and this is your diamond here, which is very precious to us, that is your fucose H antigen. So can I say now in some of the H antigens will be converted into A, okay? Some of the antigens will be converted into B. Some of the antigens will be converted into B. And some of the antigens will not be converted at all. So they will just have diamond with them. That is, they'll be H. But because here lots of enzymes are produced, can I say if I am saying which blood group is this person, can I say this person will be expressing a blood group of AB? So what is the blood group of this person? AB. So if somebody asks you which blood group has maximum H antigen, or maximum H antigen is present in which blood group? So now you have seen all the blood groups. So can I say that this was poor O antigen, okay, where neither Nag, neither galactose was being produced. So all the substance remains as H only. So can I say maximum H substance or H antigen will be present in O blood group? Okay, what is this H substance I'm talking about? See, these blood groups, okay, so I've just now told you, they're not only present on the cells, they can also be excreted in the secretions. When they are secreted in the secretions, then they are called as H substances. Okay, what are they called? H substance. So they can call you as, they can tell you as H antigen, or they can call as H substance, doesn't matter, okay? Also remember, secretion is the principle of another gene, okay, which is beyond your undergraduate curriculum, but okay, any Anyhow, there's a gene called SC. Okay, SC gene basically defines that whether you will be a secretor or you will not be a secretor. So if you have SC gene, this H antigen will be released in secretion as H substances. Okay, if you don't have SC gene, your H antigen will not be secreted as H substance. Simple as that. So which gene defines the secretory status of the person? SC gene. Okay, so that's H substance. So you should not be having any doubt. So which blood group has maximum H substance? O. Whereas which blood group has least H substance? Obviously AB. Why? Because there are so many enzymes. There is NAG transferase, there is galactose transferase. So therefore majority of them are converted into A and B antigens. So obviously there will be very less H antigen which will be left, isn't it? So least amount of H antigen is present in the AB blood group. Are we clear with this? Yes. So that is about your blood group. Okay, now if I'm talking about a person who has AB antigens on the red cell, will he have any antibody? Obviously not. He already has a red cell with H antigen, with A antigen, with B antigen, so there'll be no antibodies in this person. Now when I'm talking about a person, okay, so which substance, okay, so let's say if I am AB blood group, okay, so my dad is AB blood group. Okay, my dad is AB blood group. Okay, so because my dad is AB blood group, so he does not have any antibodies in his blood. So if I want to transfuse him, okay, with any blood, okay, there'll be no antibodies to react to any antigen which is coming, isn't it? So these AB blood group persons are called as universal recipients. What are they called as? Universal recipients. Universal recipient. Okay, so my dad is a universal recipient. Okay, so very happy that, okay, we can give him blood from any blood group. Okay, but okay, so this is not actually true because we have a lot of other antibodies which we have to check, but for knowing, this is a universal recipient. Whereas my mom, I just now told you, she's O blood group. Okay, so when she's O blood group, okay, now she has so many antibodies in her blood, anti A and anti B, but her cells do not contain any antigen. Her cells do not have A antigen, does not have B antigen. Because the cells don't have A and B antigen, so therefore she can give blood to anybody. So anybody, when she's giving cells, if she gives cells to anybody, then because they have no antigens on them, the antibodies will not find any substrate to attack, isn't it? So O blood group people are called as universal donors. Okay, what are they called as? Universal donor. So my family is a very unique family in relation to the blood banking. Okay, so this is universal donor. You understand? So universal donor. So my mother, O blood group, is a universal donor. My father is an AB blood group, so he's a universal recipient. Do you understand that? So O blood group is a universal donor, AB blood group is a universal recipient. Okay. Now, suppose, let's go to the opposite part of the spectrum. Now you have understood this. So once, let's say, so now I'm talking about a unique scenario here. Let's say these are the red cells, but these red cells have neither A, neither B. They neither have A, neither have B, neither have H. Okay, so these cells do not have any antigens. So even fucose is not there. Neither A, neither A, neither B, neither A, neither B, neither H. So it don't have anything. Okay, so now that means that here chromosome number 19 is not producing fucosyl transferase. They are not producing fucosyl transferase. So fucose itself is not being produced. So such patients are called as Bombay blood group. Okay, so these group of people are called as Bombay blood group. And it becomes very, very important for us to identify these group of patients. Why? Because their cells do not have H antigen, neither have A antigen, neither have B antigen. So that means if you look at their blood, if you look at their plasma, it will have all the antibodies. Okay, they will have natural anti-H, anti-A and anti-B antibodies. So their plasma will contain all the antibodies, anti-A, anti-B and anti-H. So this becomes very, very important for us to identify them. Okay, why? I'll just tell you after, with an example after this. So this is your Bombay blood group, which you have to understand. This is a Bombay blood group. Now, do you remember Bombay blood group? So Bombay blood group was found in Bombay, okay, and these the prevalence of Bombay blood group, for your information, is quite not very high, but it is present in India. It's quite common. If I see my blood bank itself, in a month we get approximate one case of blood Bombay blood group. So it's not very rare, okay, it's not very rare, it's quite common. Also, you should remember, we have already started about this. Do you remember this, that Bombay blood group people are usually associated with leukocyte adhesion defect type 2. Okay, so Bombay blood group people usually have more prevalence of leukocyte adhesion defect type 2. I hope you remember, type 2 was an absence of Cl-Lewis-X. Okay, Cl-Lewis-X is also a carbohydrate moiety. Okay, so because this is also a carbohydrate moiety, fucose is also a carbohydrate moiety, there is high chances that LAD2 people do not have fucose transferase also. That is why, okay, so this is called as a glycosylation defect. Okay, so type 2 is also called as glycosylation defect type 2C. Okay, so this is probably because lot of carbohydrate moieties are not being produced. So remember, Bombay blood groups are usually associated with leukocyte adhesion defect type 2. Okay, right. So we'll be studying out more about Bombay blood group when we go in further. But everybody should be clear with this till now. Everybody clear with this till now? Yes. So that is your Bombay blood group. Now, one more point here, okay, so you studied about genotype, isn't it? So when I talk about genotype now, one more point, suppose I'm saying that a person has A blood group, okay, so it might be that he gets one copy of A antigen, let's say, okay, I'll tell you my example only, so you will be able to remember, okay. So I just now told you, my mother is O blood group and my father is AB blood group. So okay, so obviously in my dad, let's say there are two types of alleles, A and B, both are present, and my mother has no antigens present on it. Okay, so that means they only have H antigen on them. So they don't have any other antigen, but only H is present. So let's say if this occurs, can I say the blood group that will be formed here will be A and H? Okay, so this person who has one allele of A and one of H, this blood group is also called as A blood group. This is a A blood group, but on one he has H and other he has A. So this is A blood group. Let's talk about another situation. Suppose some father is A blood group and mother is, let's say, AB blood group, and he gets, suppose some other person get both the alleles of A. Okay, though both will be expressed. I hope you remember blood group system is a codominant system. So he get both A, okay. So then this is also A blood group. So please remember everybody, if somebody is saying that somebody is A blood group, it can be that both the alleles are A, or it can be that one allele is only having A, the other allele is only having H. So it can be presented as, okay, how it can be presented as? Can I say A blood group, if I'm writing it as A blood group, so A blood group can either be AA or it can be AH. So B blood group can be BB or it can be BH. Okay, O blood group, if I'm saying, that means they are only HH. If I'm saying AB, that means they are only AB, isn't it? If I'm saying Bombay blood group, that means they don't even have H. So when you don't have H, you just write it as small h. So Bombay blood group means they don't have H antigen, so we just write them as small h. So HH. So these are the total genotypic findings of the blood group system. Okay, so we can have which all genotypes of the of any blood group. So A can have these, B can have this, O is usually this, ABO is this, and Bombay is too small H, that is they don't have H antigen also. So these are your genotypic and phenotypic. Okay, so this is what is a phenotype, what we call it as a blood group, and this is what is called as a genotype. So genetically it will be this, and phenotypically it will be this. I hope you're clear with this. Yes, everybody's clear with genotype and phenotype of the blood group systems. So everybody, are you clear with ABO system till now? Whatever we have started in ABO system, are you clear with this? Yes? Okay. So once we are clear with this, now let's come to Rh antigens now. Okay. So let's come to the Rh antigens now. So in contrast to ABO system is sugar. Rh is your proteins. So Rh is your proteins. Okay. So these are proteins. And usually Rh system is usually present only on red cells. Okay. So Rh antigen is usually present on RBCs. Rh antigens are usually present on the red blood cells. Okay. So if I am going to talk about Rh antigens, everybody is going to let's go and talk about Rh antigens. So Rh antigens, when I am talking, these are actually proteins, and these proteins are called as 12 pass proteins. What are they called as? 12 pass proteins. That doesn't mean that they have just passed 12th standard. No. What does that mean? That means if you draw the structure of these like this, okay, so they form loops, 6 loops outside, 6 loops inside, like this. So they form loops like this, and they have 6 loops outside and 6 loops inside, and these proteins are very strongly linked to ankyrin. Okay, so they are linked to ankyrin 4.2 proteins. So they are linked inside to ankyrin 4.2 proteins. I hope you remember this RBC. Okay, in spherocytosis there is ankyrin deficiency. Do you remember that? So these are a very important part of the protein system of your red cells, and they are 12 pass proteins, and they are attached to the cytoskeleton of the red blood cells, to the ankyrin, to the 4.2 component, all that, and they form an integral part of the red cell membrane. So these are Rh antigens. Okay, so let us see how these Rh antigens are being produced now. So remember, when I'm again going to the DNA, but this time we are focusing on chromosome number 1. We are focusing on chromosome number 1. So on chromosome number 1, we have 2 genes. Okay, so how many genes are there? We have 2 genes here. One gene is called as RhD gene. The other gene is called as RhCe gene. Okay, so we have 2 genes here, RhD gene and RhCe gene. Okay, so RhD and RhCe genes. Okay, so these genes code for some antigens. They code for some antigens. So RhD codes for D antigen and CE codes for C and E. So this is like this. Okay, so RhD antigen codes only for D antigen, whereas CE codes for capital C, small c, capital E, small e. So therefore, how many type of antigens can be present in the Rh blood group system? We can have capital D, there is no small d. Please remember, there is no small d. Okay, so it can be capital D, it can be capital C, small c, capital E, small e. These are your blood group system antigens which are present in Rh. So can I say that Rh antigen is actually made up of D antigen, or it can be made up of C, small c, E, small e? These are the antigens which are present in the Rh blood group system. Now, once we are pretty clear about this, these Rh antigens, now you should remember, okay, let's remember that out of these, which is most common? So most common antigen of all this is D, which is most immunogenic. Most immunogenic is also D. So most common is also D, most immunogenic is also D. Okay, so we have most common also D, we have most immunogenic also D. That's most common and most immunogenic. Okay, now, so that is Rh antigen. So whenever precisely we talk about Rh antigen, so most commonly we are basically concerned with D antigens. Others are also there, but we are more predominantly concerned about D, because D is most immunogenic. Followed by D, C is most immunogenic. Followed by D, C is the immunogenic. So remember, this is your Rh antigen. And in contrast to ABO, they are proteins. Now, because these are proteins, so remember here, the antibodies, to them are not present naturally. Antibodies to them are not present naturally. Okay, so if my red blood group system, I have D antigen, so I will not have anti-D in my body. I will not have anti-D in my body. So remember, these are not natural antibodies. So there are no natural antibodies which are present against Rh antigen. Number two, if antibodies are formed, antibodies will be formed only when we are sensitized. Only when we are sensitized. Okay. What do you mean by sensitized? Now suppose I am, I am D negative. Suppose I am D negative. I am Rh negative. Suppose I am Rh negative. Okay. And somebody gives me D positive blood. Somebody gives me D positive blood. Or if I have D positive fetus in me. If I have D positive fetus in me. So these D positive cells, either they come through blood transfusion or they come through the fetus. So these D positive cells will trigger my immune system. Okay. So normally my immune system does not know D antigen. So this D antigen will be foreign for my body. And our body will start forming immediately IgG antibodies against these D antigens. So, in contrast to ABO blood system, ABO system usually has IgM antibodies. Here, the predominant antibodies are IgG antibodies. Here, predominantly the antibodies which are formed are IgG. And they are formed only when we are sensitized. Only when we are sensitized. If you sensitize, I will start forming antibodies. Okay. And then it will start causing damage. So these antibodies are formed only when we are sensitized, and because they are IgG antibodies, they can cross the placenta, and therefore we can have ABO hemorrhagic disease of newborn. ABO hemorrhagic disease of newborn. So remember, ABO hemorrhagic disease of the newborn, we can have Rh hemorrhagic disease of the newborn. So remember, Rh hemorrhagic disease, normally if I talk about hemorrhagic disease of newborn, it is usually Rh. Okay, ABOs are very, very rare, and they are very, very mild also. Okay, because the titer of IgG antibody is not high. Whereas in Rh, the titers of the antibodies are very high and the disease is severe. So remember that we have, whenever I talk about hemolytic disease of newborn, it is usually Rh hemolytic disease of newborn. Okay, usually. Okay, so that is your Rh antigen which we have studied. Okay, so now if I don't have capital D antigen, then I write myself as DD. D means both the alleles are not having D antigen, so this will be small d. So there is no D antigen. Please remember, small d antigen is not there. Small d antigen is not there. Only we have capital D antigen. Whereas in C, we have small c, capital C, capital E, small e. Okay, so this is to be known. Everybody should know this. So please remember, what did you study in Rh blood group system? It is present on which chromosome? Chromosome number one. So can I say, if I make a table like this, okay, if I make a table like this, can I say that when I talk about chromosome number 1 has Rh antigen? When I talk about chromosome number 9, AB blood group is on this. When I say chromosome number 19, okay, that is the mother, okay, H. So remember, simple way to remember is 1 is Rh. 9 is ABO. Join 1 and 9 together, it is H. 1 and 9 together is H. That's the blood group system which everybody has to know. Okay, that's that should be very, very clear to everybody. Okay, now that was your Rh blood group system, and usually IgG antibodies formed only when you're sensitized, and we have already studied that it is usually D, C and E. So there's no small d antigen, that's what you have learned, and it's a protein. Okay, so that is about ABO and Rh blood group system. Okay, now before going through the testing, let's look at some other blood group systems which we all should be clear. Okay, so immediately after D, if somebody asks you after Rh antigen, which is the next immunogenic antigen? So the next important immunogenic antigen is KEL. Okay, so after ABO, the next immunogenic antigen is KEL. kill antigen is a very immunogenic antigen again, and it is a very, very important antigen again, okay? So remember, kill antigen, okay? So these are usually present on the red cells and they are very important. So clinically, they are very immunogenic. After D, they are after the Rh antigen, they are next immunogenics. So therefore, whenever we give blood to thalassemics, we not only test for their D, C, E, we also test for the KEL blood group, KEL antigens, okay? That's very, very important. And another thing that you have to remember here is, there is a phenotype, okay, which is very, very popular, which you should know, MacLeod phenotype, okay? So very popular question that they ask you in this is this, okay? This is called MacLeod phenotype. Do you know what is MacLeod phenotype? So whenever a person does not have KEL antigens, then it is called MacLeod phenotype. So these group of patients typically present with presence of acanthocytes. Okay, in RBCs you would have studied acanthocytes. Acanthocytes means red cells with irregular peaks coming up like this. So these are acanthocytes. So we have acanthocytes. So acanthocytes can be seen in various conditions which you've studied, like liver disease. Okay, but it can also be present in MacLeod phenotype. So remember, MacLeod phenotype contains acanthocytes, number one. Number two, you should remember is that these patients are the ones which have high tendency of getting chronic granulomatous disease. So everybody will go to the inflammation and study about chronic granulomatous disease. And remember that chronic granulomatous disease patients usually are associated with MacLeod phenotypes. They're usually associated with MacLeod phenotype, and they have lot of muscular dysfunctions also. So muscular dysfunctions are also present in these. So MacLeod phenotype is a very important phenotype of those group of patients who do not have KEL blood group, and they have acanthocytes, chronic granulomatous disease, and muscular dysfunctions, which everybody should be very clear. Now let's come to the second important blood group system. Okay, second important blood group system. Here the second important blood group system which I want you to know is, again, very, very important, Duffy antigen. So Duffy antigen. So remember, when I talk about Duffy antigen, so again, Duffy antigen is also present on the red cells. It is present on the red cells, and it is coded usually by a gene called DARC gene. So this question I had asked on my Facebook group sometime back, that what is this DARC gene? Okay, so this is Duffy antigen receptor for cytokines. Duffy antigen receptor for cytokines. So remember, this Duffy antigen actually is a receptor for lot of cytokines. Okay, especially it is a receptor for interleukin 8 and monocyte chemoattractant protein. I hope you remember these chemokines, okay? So these chemokines were very important in inflammation you studied. So they act on the cell. They can enter into the cells through this receptor. Apart from this, everybody should remember Plasmodium vivax and Plasmodium. How many of you know about this? Okay, Plasmodium novelisi enters through Duffy antigen. Do you know about this antigen, Plasmodium novelisi? Do you know about this? Anybody? Any idea about this? No? So remember, this is a very recent update which everybody should be knowing. Okay? So remember, okay, when I'm talking about Plasmodium novelisi, okay, so remember this point always, that this was one of the very important cause of current malaria which occurred in Malaysia. Okay, so in Malaysia they found people suffering from malaria and they were not able to identify the subtype of malaria, and then they found this malaria, Plasmodium novelisi. Then they found that actually Plasmodium novelisi is a typical malarial parasite of monkeys, primates. It is a typical malarial parasite that does not affect human, that affect primates, animals, okay, like monkeys. So it was a parasite of primates, but somehow when humans come in contact with primates, this Plasmodium novelisi attacks humans also, and this caused an outbreak in Malaysia, and then it was discovered. For your general knowledge, there was a person called as Balbir Singh, okay, who was an Indian, who discovered this, actually identified that this looks like Plasmodium novalis. So I've already told you, human brains, especially Indian brains, are most brilliant. Okay, you can't break Indian brains, they're most brilliant brains. Okay, so they found that this enters through Duffy blood group and Duffy antigen. It enters into the red cells through Duffy antigens. Anyhow, so that was your Duffy antigens. Okay, so Duffy antigens are again they are important because this is very important antigen through which receptors enter. And the second is that it is a receptor for Plasmodium, especially Plasmodium vivax and Plasmodium novalis. Okay, now coming to the third important antigen which we had to know, okay, which we had to know is your again a very 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 important antigen which we have to know is, this is called Lewis antigen. Okay, so what is this Lewis antigen? So please remember, Lewis antigen is actually a very unique antigen again, because this is not produced by the red cells. So this is not produced by the red cell itself, not produced by the cells. So this antigen is secreted antigen. This antigen is secreted antigen. Okay, this antigen is secreted antigens. Okay, this is a secreted antigen. Okay, so Lewis antigens, they are not formed by the red cells, they are secreted. Okay, they are some of the secreted antigens. And you know, once I say that they are secreted antigens, okay, so they are secreted antigens. So because they are secreted by some epithelial cells of the body, then what happens is these antigens are adsorbed, they are adsorbed to the red cells. These antigens are adsorbed to the red cells. So they are adsorbed to the red cells. So these antigens are adsorbed to the red cells. So these are called Lewis antigens. And remember, these Lewis antigens are present in the secretions. That is why they predominantly present in the secretions. Okay, they are predominantly present in the secretions, and they can be adsorbed on the red cells. So these are Lewis antigens. Unique point: they are not made by the red cells, but they are secreted antigens. Okay. Also, so we have studied about three major antigens: Kell, Duffy, and Lewis. So remember, again, one very important point is that Duffy antigen is also the 12-pass antigen, just like RH. Okay, so this is also 12-pass antigen, that is 6 outside, 6 inside, same way. Okay, like your RH antigen. Okay, so these are the other blood group systems. Now, once we are clear with all the blood group systems that we have studied, let's see few, you know, updates, few terms which we should know before going to the diagnosis. Sometimes they give you this in exam. So first is, what do you understand by the term RH null? RH null means those people who neither have C antigen, neither have D antigen, neither have E antigen in the body. Null means no RH antigen is present. Neither C, neither D, neither E. That is called RH null. What do you understand by the term RH positive? Usually when I say the RH positive, we imply a D antigen. So D positive, if a person is D positive, he is considered as RH positive. And obviously the antibodies are not natural. Okay, so antibodies will always be made whenever the person is sensitized. So if I am saying RH negative, means this is usually a person who is D negative. So D negative is called as RH negative. Whereas when all are negative, then it is called as RH null. When all are negative, this is called as RH null. Okay, again, coming to the third important thing, there is a term called as weak D. What do you understand by the term weak D? Whenever, suppose this is the cell, okay, and let's say he has lot of D antigens are present on the cell like this, okay. So this is a normal D person who has lot of D antigens on its surface, okay. This is normal D person. Now look at this person and tell me what is happening to this. What is happening to this in contrast to this? So the number of D antigens on the red cells are decreased. Number of D antigens on the red cells are decreased. Such person is called weak D. Such person is called weak D. Okay. So what is the implication of weak D? Weak D is, that means if this person is a donor, okay, that means suppose there is a person who's going to come and give blood to you, okay, and he has this weak T, less D antigens on them, then this should be regarded as Rh positive. Whereas if he is a recipient, okay, and you're going to give blood to this person, then he should be regarded as Rh negative. What do you understand by this? What does this mean? See, you know, if I am D negative, I should not get even a one spicule of D positive antigen in me. Because if I get it, my antibodies will start forming against it. Because my body will get sensitized. And you don't want to sensitize your body, because once it gets sensitized, it will start forming lots and lots of antibodies, isn't it? So therefore, if even he has little bit of D, it is positive for us as a donor. So I do not want to receive a blood from that person who has even little amount of D antigen. Okay. So for a person who is weak D, I will treat him as D positive, and I will never give this blood to the D negative person. Okay. Whereas whenever I'm talking about the recipient, okay, I'm a recipient now, okay. So suppose I'm a weak D person and I'm a recipient, okay. So I'm a recipient means I have less D on my body. So I might have, okay. So I have less D on my body. So if you want to give blood to me, the safest option for me is give a D negative blood, okay, so that I do not get sensitized to any extra D which you are sending it to me, okay. So when I am a recipient, I will be treated as D negative. If I am weak D, if I am a donor, I will be treated as D positive. So always remember, weak D, donor is positive, and as a recipient, he should be considered as Rh negative, okay. That is the concept of D, okay. Now, here is one more term which you should know is partial D. Okay, partial D. So to understand partial D, let me give you an example. Suppose let's consider Rh antigen as a table, as a chair or as a stool which has four legs, as a table or as a stool which has four legs. So normally the structure of Rh is like this, that it should have, let's say, four antigenic determinants. So it has four legs like this. But instead of this, let's see what happens now. So this is the person now. If you look at this person, instead of four legs, now he has only two legs. Okay, two antigenic determinants are absent. Okay, two antigenic determinants are absent. So this is called that there is partial missing of some antigenic determinants. And this is what is called as partial D. What is this called as? Partial D. So now, do you understand the terms? So Rh null means when you don't have CDE, Rh positive means when you're D positive, Rh negative means negative, weak D means when you have less epitopes, less D antigens, so you will be considered differently, and partial D means that your antigenic determinants are absent. Instead of four, you have only two or only one, okay, then you are partial D, okay. So partial D patients can form antibodies against the other D determinants, okay, antigenic determinants, beyond the scope of an undergraduate, okay, but anyhow, that's partial D. So these terms should be very clear to everybody. Everybody clear with this Rh antigens and all the blood group antigens? So that is basic about all the blood group antigens, okay. So when I'm talking about testing, okay, how are we going to test these patients, okay, for blood grouping, what are the testing modalities that we have? So testing modalities, when we talk, you know, there was earlier we used to do slide testing, okay, or that's what you have done in your undergraduate exams, isn't it? Slide testing, okay. So you used to do it in a tile, slide or tiles you used to do. Nowadays we don't do in tiles, we can do slides but not tiles, okay. So that's testing on a tile or a slide, okay. Or we can have tube testing, in which we test on tube, and the latest one is a gel technology, okay. Or this is called as column chromatography or column agglutination technology, anything, column chromatography or column agglutination technology, okay. So commonly called as gel techniques, okay, gel technique. So these are the testing protocols that we are having. So first, let's say, how do we do it? So let's come to the very common which we used to do, slide testing, okay, or tile testing. So for tile testing, what do you have? You have anti-seras, okay? You have anti-sera. So you have anti-A, anti-B. You can have anti-AB if you want to use it, or B, if you don't want to use it, you can just use anti-D, okay? So these are three mandatory things that we use, okay? A, B and anti-D. And so that there should be no confusion, we have color coded them, okay? Anti-A is always blue color because it has tryptan blue in it, okay? So what is the dye which is present here is tryptan blue. Tryptan blue. That is why this is blue in color. That is your anti-A. Then we have anti-B, which is yellow in color. Okay, this is because of tartrazine. Okay, this is because of tartrazine. Because of this, this is yellow in color. And then we have anti-D. Anti-D is, in most of the places, is usually greenish in color. Okay, so anti-D. Okay. So, AB is usually white in color. If they're using, they are white in color. Okay, why do we give them color coding is so that, okay, so why do we give them color coding is so that you can be pretty sure that you have added anti-sera or not. Okay, if you are not sure, suppose you don't add anti-sera, you just add A cells and you forget to put anti-sera, then what will happen? You will not be able to see the reaction and you might give a false results. So that is why always, okay, we should add anti-sera first. Always we should add anti-sera first so that we can be pretty sure that we have added anti-sera. Okay, so that is the first thing that we have to know in blood grouping. How do we do it? Okay, so first add anti-sera and after that you add the cells. Okay, so how do you take cells? So you take blood from the person, and you we centrifuge it and we make 30 to 40% suspension of the cells. Okay, so we make 30 to 40% suspension of the cells. So 30 to 40% of the cells we make it. This is called 30 to 40% suspension of the cells we make it. And this suspension, we contain these cells and we get a button and we get a cells in this and these cells we put in this anti-sera in the ratio of 1:1. So cell to anti-sera ratio, cell to anti-sera ratio should be 1:1. Cell to anti-sera ratio should be 1:1. Okay, now you add the cells. So first you add A cells, okay, then you add B cells, then you add B cells. Okay, so let's say A cells, then we are going to add B cells, and then we are going to put cells in D. Now if you start getting clumping, okay, if you start getting clumping in this, so okay, in this and this, if you start getting clumping in this and this, that means A antigen was present in the cells. You had already added anti-A. Because you had already added anti-A, so agglutination occurred. So this patient has a blood group of A, and because D is positive, positive. So this is called A positive. What is this called? A positive. So this was done earlier. So this is called slide test, or this was called as tile test, which was done earlier. Nowadays we don't do it like that. Okay. So nowadays the current protocol of doing blood grouping is we should do forward and reverse typing. Now in the blood group we should always do forward and reverse typing. This is mandatorily to be done and you should be very, very clear with this. So you should do forward and reverse typing. Okay, so when I talk about forward grouping, whenever I talk about forward grouping, okay, so forward means we are going to check the cells. Reverse means I am going to check the serum. So forward means I'm going to check the cells, reverse means I'm going to check the serum. Okay, so let's understand how do we do that. Okay, so now before going to this, I should tell you why this has been developed. Okay, so let me give you an example first and the importance of this, or should I first explain you the technique and then example? So let's understand the technique first and then I'll give you the example, so maybe then you will be able to correlate it better. Now forward is for cells and reverse it for sera. Okay, so let's see. So what do we do in this is, okay, what do we do it in this is that we again, so this you can do it in tube. Usually we do it in tubes. Ideally we should do it in the tubes. So I'll, let me make a tube for you. So this is the tubes. Okay, so I again add anti A, anti B. Okay, so you can put anti AB if you want to. You can put anti AB if you want to. But if you don't want to, you cannot. It's your wish. Okay. But these three must be there. Okay. Anti A, anti B, and anti D. So now, what did you do? You added anti D, you added anti B, and you added anti A. Okay. In the tube. Okay. Now, reverse is for sera. Okay, so now again, what you did, you took known A cells. This known A cells can be taken from the company, which can give you manufactured A cells, or you can take it from a well-known person. If you can take a blood from the known A blood group person and take out the cells from it, okay, purify it and put it. Purify means wash it properly and put it. You have to wash three times at least so that all the adsorbed antibodies can be removed. Okay, so three time washing is mandatory. Okay. So you can take A cells, you can do put B cells here, and then we are putting O cells. Again, O cells are the cells taken from a well-known O blood group person, okay, or you can take it from company also. So now, you know, A cells will have A antigen on them, B cells will have B antigen on them, and O cells will have which antigen on them? I am sure you know this, H antigen on them, isn't it? So now let us see. So now what do we do is, now we start putting cells. So let's say this is a pulse patient and I put cells in this. I put cells in A, cells in A, cells in B, cells in D. And what do you put in the cells? So here we have already put cells. Now you put serum of the person, A, B and O. So you added serum of the person. Now let us see what happens. So now you don't get agglutination in A. What does this mean? So this is probably because he does not have A antigen on the cells, so no agglutination, nothing, negative. So I will write it negative. Now you don't get, so let's cross only, ideally we'll write negative. So let's say you don't get any agglutination in B. That means he does not have B antigen also. He does not have B antigen also. Okay. You get agglutination here in D. So this is positive. Okay. So this person is positive. So the cells had D antigen, anti-D reacts and it is positive. So it's positive blood group. Okay. Now in A cells, again, when you put A cells, so if it is, if I am saying this is O blood group, let's say I am saying this is O blood group. So O blood group person means he will have anti-A in his serum. He will have anti-B. But will he have anti-H? No, because anti-H antigen is present on O. So if I am saying anybody is O blood group, I hope you remember that that means he will have only H antigen on his cells, because fucosyl transferase will be there, NAG and galactose will not be there. So this will have H antigen on them. So he will not have anti-H antibody. So because anti-A antibodies is present here, agglutination will occur here. Okay, anti-B antibody is there, so agglutination will occur here. Because there is no anti-H antibody, you will not get any agglutination here. So you will get agglutination here, you will get agglutination here, but no agglutination in the O cells. So can I say this person is a blood group O positive? So the, what is the blood group of this person? O positive, because there was no agglutination in anti-A, anti-B in the cells in the forward. Whereas in the reverse, when we put, there was agglutination in anti-A and anti-B. So this was agglutination present in anti-A and anti-B. So this blood group was O positive. Now, let me give you a situation now. Again, no agglutination in A, no agglutination in anti-B, but agglutination present in D. Okay, fine. No agglutination. So agglutination present in anti-A. So he has anti-A antibody. Agglutination present in B cells, that is he has anti-B antibody, and agglutination present in here also. What does this mean? That means he also had anti-H antibodies. So H antibody, anti-H antibodies can be present only in which blood group patient? Bombay blood group, because you know Bombay blood group is the blood group which does not have H antigen. So when he does not have H antigen, he will have anti-H antibodies. So this patient will be a Bombay blood group. You understand? So this is your Bombay blood group. No agglutination in A and B, but agglutination present in A cells, B cells and O cells. So this is your Bombay blood group. Now, once everybody is clear with this, let me give you a situation. I told you, I'll tell you an example. Okay. So let's, so this is one of the example which usually, which I explain it to my students every time. Suppose a person has got road traffic accident, okay, and is dying on the road due to bleeding, okay. You immediately take this patient to the hospital and they said he's bleeding a lot. You have to immediately give him the blood. So they said, okay, do you have a blood group card? Do you know your blood group? He says, yes, I am O positive. Okay, very nice. So now if you go to the peripheral centers of the country, usually they will do, still they will follow tile blood group system. So what they will do, they will put anti-A, anti-sera, okay, 1:1, reaction done, okay, anti-B put done, and anti-D done, okay. So yes, no reaction with anti-A, no reaction with anti-B, D is positive, so this is O blood group, give him O blood group. Okay, in bag, quickly bring O blood group bag and give. So they don't usually, when there is an emergency, they usually don't do forward and reverse grouping. So what will happen? Let's presume this person was Bombay blood group. He didn't knew this, that he's Bombay blood group. They had only done tile testing. Okay, so they had only done tile testing. They had taken their cells. They had only tested for A and B. It was negative. So they labeled him as O positive and sent him. But actually, he didn't had H also, which was never tested. So he was reported as O blood group. Okay. Now, suppose this is Bombay blood group. Which antibodies will be present in his blood? There'll be anti-A, there'll be anti-B, and there'll be anti-H. Now, okay. Suppose you're giving O, you say, okay, very good. So this is my patient. I'm going to draw it for you. So this is the patient. You have reported him as O positive, but he's unfortunately Bombay blood group. So he has anti-A in his blood, anti-B in his blood, and anti-H in the blood. But you tested quickly and you found that this is O blood group. So you took this blood bag from the blood bank and you say, very nice. Okay, so let's transfuse him. Now, this is an O bag. O bag means this will have which antigen on it? H antigen. Okay, so this blood bag has H antigen on it. And you're going to give this blood to this person. Okay, you're going to give this blood to this person. Okay, and you know ABO antibodies are IgM antibody. As already this patient is bleeding due to road traffic accident and you give him this blood. Immediately, as soon as you inject him H antigen cells, anti-H antibody will lyse them and the patient will present with acute intravascular hemolysis. Already he is dying due to road traffic accident. You killed him immediately because of intravascular hemolysis. He dies immediately. So this is the highest degree of negligence that you can do. So the rule today, take a rule from me, okay, and take it in your brain. As an interns, you should know this, okay? Anybody. So whenever you do blood grouping, it has to be done both forward and reverse. You should have done reverse also. If you would have done reverse, okay, you would have just added, you would just have taken the serum of the person and added O cells in it. If you add O cells in it, okay, then what will happen? O cells have H antigen. This plasma has anti-H. Immediately the agglutination would have occurred and you would have said, yes, this is Bombay blood group. Remember, Bombay blood groups are very common in our country and shouldn't be missed because Bombay blood group is a precious blood and any person with Bombay blood group can receive blood only from Bombay blood group. So today from this class, you have learned this point that you will always do forward and reverse typing. Okay, you can do forward and reverse typing either on slide or on tube. That doesn't matter. But you have to do checking for both forward and reverse. Ideally, it has to be done in tubes. So in tubes, whenever, remember, when you do it in tubes, okay, then, okay, usually we take 5% suspension of the cells, okay. So 5% suspension of the cells should be taken. In contrast to the slides where you are taking 30 to 40% suspension, here you will take 5% suspension, number one. And number two, you should remember the ratio now changes. It should be 2:1. That is 2 volumes of anti-sera, 1 volume of cells.
okay, 2 volumes of anti-sera and 1 volume of cell, okay. And remember, this a good 5% suspension of the red cells is usually the color of this blood is tomato red color. Okay, that's the color of a good suspension. It is tomato reddish in color. That's a good suspension. When you see that, you can find that this is tomato colored. Yes, it's a good suspension. And the ratio is 2:1. Now, coming to the last technique of the blood grouping, which we that's the recent update, that is column agglutination technology or gel technology. So what is a gel technology is? Gel technology is simple, okay? These are preloaded cards that come, okay, from various companies like Diaclone, okay? So they are preloaded cards which come here, and these cards are already loaded with anti-seras, okay? So they are preloaded with anti-seras. So they have anti-A loaded, they have loaded with anti-B already loaded, so there's no problem, okay? Anti-AB can be there, anti-D can be there, already the cells are put like this. So it's a preloaded thing. You don't have to do anything. You just have to add the cells and the serum and your result will be quickly seen. Now here, because this anti-sera is put in the gel, okay, so as soon as the reaction occurs, if the agglutination occurs, cells will be trapped on the top only. They'll not be able to pass down because it's a gel full of anti-A. As soon as the agglutination occurs, the cells are trapped on the top only. They can't go down because agglutination occurs, and gel will not allow this agglutinate to pass. But if antigen is not present on the cells, there's no antigen antibody reaction, gel will allow cells to pass. Gel will allow cells to pass. So on a gel technology, whenever you can see blood cells up, that means it's a positive result. Whenever you see blood cells down, that means there's no antigen or no reaction, antigen antibody reaction. So this is negative. So whenever it is up, it is positive. Whenever it is down, it is negative. You understand that? So that is the basis of your gel technology, which you have to remember, that if antigen antibody reaction occurs, it is trapped up only. Okay, it will not come down. If the reaction does not occur, it will come down. Okay, so now let us see what we have started and let's understand, because seeing is learning. When you see something, you learn it well. So look at this. Can you see this? This is anti-A blue because it has trypsin blue. Anti-B because it has tartrazine. And this is green, it is anti-D, which can be monoclonal or polyclonal. Okay. Now, can you see this reaction here? Can you solve this quiz here? So this is a simple tile test which you do. So can you see agglutination in the A and agglutination in the D? So this is A positive. Okay. Now, coming to the next, you can see agglutinate in the A, agglutinate in the B, agglutinate in the D. So this is your AB positive. No agglutination in A, no agglutination in the B, but agglutination in the D. So what is this? What is this? This is your O positive. But ideally, you should not do this now. You should do both forward and reverse, which you have learned. Okay. Now, let's go to the next thing. So this is how you should do ideally. You should do forward and you should do reverse. Okay. So forward and reverse. Now, this is what is called gel card technology. If it is trapped up, it is positive. If it comes down, it is negative. Now, look at this, okay? So, if you look at this, again, can you see this? You have added A, which is blue. B is yellow, okay? This is D, okay? Then, control they have put. Then, A cells and B cells. Now, can you see? Cells are trapped on the top. That means this is positive. So, this is positive for A. B is negative, so negative, okay? D is positive, trapped on the top, so positive, okay? Control is just for taking autoimmune hemolytic anemia. So autoimmune hemolytic anemias, usually there is auto antigen antibody reaction. So this control does not have any anti-sera. So without having anti-sera itself, if you see button on the top, that means it's an autoimmune hemolytic anemia. Okay, so that is what we should always put controlled. We always do that because sometimes, you know, otherwise you will get agglutination and everything and you will give a wrong blood group. So therefore, first you have to see whether antigen antibody reaction does not occur by itself. If it is occurring by itself, that means it's an autoimmune hemolytic anemia, which has to be worked up. Okay, so that's why we always put controls. Okay, now A means the cells are coming down. That means there is no anti-A. So perfect, confirmed. But we have anti-B here. So anti-B means this is A blood group. So this confirms that this is a A positive person. Okay. So let me give you one more. Okay, so let's see this one. So no reaction with A, but full reaction with B. So this is B blood group. Okay, no reaction with D also. So B negative. Okay, so look at the cells now. If it is B, means he should have anti-A. So confirmed, yes, anti-A is present. So this is your B negative. Okay, whereas look at this, we have seen this A, B, D is positive and anti-B is present. So definitely it is A positive. So that is how nowadays we do blood grouping, and we should be very clear with testing of the blood group system. Everybody should be very clear with this. Okay, right.